Welcome to Ring of Fire, I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The same Neocon warhawks who pushed us into Iraq are making their way back to the national stage. Filmmaker Robbie Martin will be here to explain what's happening. Talcum powder has been linked to ovarian cancer in women, and we'll explain everything you need to know about this toxic product. And Super Tuesday 2016 is in the history books. We'll bring you our analysis in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. You start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
So, yesterday was Super Tuesday, and nothing too exciting really happened if you've been following the polls. On the Democratic side, Bernie Sanders did win the states of Oklahoma, Minnesota, Colorado, and Vermont, with Hillary Clinton sweeping most of the rest and Massachusetts remaining a virtual tie. The interesting thing, which again was predicted and expected, was that Hillary Clinton absolutely swept the African American and Latino votes in the southern states. While that is important and it does highlight Bernie Sanders' biggest weakness as a candidate, here's the issue with saying that that changes things. Those states that Hillary Clinton won are all red states. Every one of them. Every one of those states in this election, no matter who is the candidate on either side, are going to vote for a Republican. So I don't think that looking at any of those states and trying to figure out what's going to happen in a general election for the Democrats is even worth doing. Those are red states, and I think people need to wake up to that reality. Yes, they get to help pick the nominee, and they helped push Hillary Clinton almost to an unbeatable status. But those states will do nothing to help the Democratic Party whatsoever in November. And that's very scary because these very same states also decided they like Donald Trump. Trump won about 7 or 8 of the contests yesterday. Cruz took the rest, except for Minnesota, where Marco Rubio finally got his first victory. But you wouldn't know it from listening to Rubio because Rubio acts like he has won every contest so far. In an interview immediately after all of the results came in, Rubio spoke to George Stephanopoulos, where he repeatedly called Donald Trump a con artist. He's absolutely right about that, but unfortunately, repeating the words con artist every 5 or 6 phrases just makes you look like an idiot, Marco Rubio. We need Trump to not be the nominee. So, Rubio, if you could just please come up with new talking points, maybe have your advisors draft a new speech, something new to say, that would be phenomenal. Because right now, you're not doing yourself any favors by sounding like a broken record. Overall, everything went as expected. Now we move on to the real contest, the big contest. You see, almost every state on Super Tuesday was a proportional state. So if Hillary got 60% of the vote, Bernie got 40, they split the delegates 60-40. Coming up on March 15th, we have Florida, which is a winner-take-all state, and Ohio, which is a winner-take-all state. Those two states combined will give close to 400, maybe a little bit more, delegates to one candidate. Not only that, both of those states are swing states in a general election. They are a much better predictor of what the country as a whole will do in November. So those are going to be the real contests. Super Tuesday was a bust. I don't put much stock in anything that happened yesterday, but March 15th is going to be the real test. And moving on, the foreign policy of the United States over the last 36 years has been a train wreck. And the same people responsible for bringing us unwinnable wars and constant conflict, they're actually trying to weasel their way back into power. So who are these people and what are they hoping to accomplish? I recently spoke with documentary film director Robbie Martin, where he helped to answer those questions. Let's take a look. Robbie, your new film series, A Very Heavy Agenda, it kind of tells the story of what's happened with our hawkish foreign policy over these last, 16 years or so, even a little before that. Give us a quick primer on the overall take of the film.
Well, it's a three-part documentary series that pretty much chronologically goes over what kind of damage mostly the neoconservatives were doing, starting with the Bush administration and then going all the way until the present. So most of the movie covers sort of the 8 years of Obama and how the neocons crept in during his administration and influenced it in terms of the Ukraine policy, the Syrian policy, our intervention in Libya, and pretty much every military intervention that happened while Obama was in office was in some way either egged on or influenced by the neocons, some of them actually inside of his own administration.
Well, one of the things that you discuss in the film is the Project for a New American Century, PNAC. That is a story that a lot of Americans either didn't pay attention to, during the, Clinton administration and the Bush administration, or they simply didn't hear about it. So tell us a little bit about PNAC and how they helped to influence, how basically our horrible foreign policy for the last couple decades.
Yeah, I mean, when most people think of neoconservative foreign policy, the names, the American Enterprise Institute, the Hudson Institute, sort of these more traditional think tanks in D.C. take top billing. But Project for the New American Century, in a lot of ways, was actually the most influential neoconservative institution over the Bush administration. In fact, I think over 15 members of PNAC actually went directly into the Bush White House immediately when he got into office. And you can look at, letters they were writing, essentially lobbying presidents ever since Bill Clinton to get us into foreign intervention. So they wrote a letter to Bill Clinton in 1998 asking him to overthrow Saddam Hussein. It was signed by people like Jeb Bush, Paul Wolfowitz, Francis Fukuyama, many others who ended up going directly into the Bush administration. And what they've been doing the whole time is essentially working as an outside agitating force to get whatever administration is currently in power to engage in some new military conflict. But I think probably the thing that would interest people the most about PNAC is in 2000, they actually wrote a document called Rebuilding America's Defenses, which lays out sort of the post 9/11 Bush world. And in that document, they ask, or they say, that to accomplish this buildup of our military in this sort of short time frame that we'd like, it would require an event, something resembling a new Pearl Harbor, a catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor, which of course a year later, 9/11 happened, and it sort of allowed them to do all the things that they laid out in this document.
And, if you look today, go online and you try to find the Project for a New American Century, at least on the surface, it appears that this group has disappeared, or they disbanded, they no longer exist online. Are they still around? Are they still out there, coordinating with each other, or have they really disbanded and gone their separate ways?
Oh, no, they're definitely still out there. I describe it to people like what Blackwater did. If you search for Blackwater now on the internet, you won't find their name anymore because they've changed their name several times since all the controversies happened. So it's a similar thing to Project for the New American Century. Somewhere around the time of 2007, 2008, they decided to close down the Project for the New American Century and essentially reopen it under a new name, which the intentions behind this reopening was not only sort of a rebranding to make people forget, what kind of reputation the neocons had. They had such a bad reputation that it was, in a very simple way, a rebranding effort. But I think more importantly, what they were trying to do, just like they tried to do during the Clinton administration, is neoconservatives realized that partisanship is actually unimportant. What's more important is trying to reach across the aisle and influence Democrats, essentially, during the Obama administration to go along with sort of this Bush foreign policy. And that's what they did. I would describe the Foreign Policy Initiative, which is their rebranded think tank, as PNAC 2.0. And they did that when as soon as Obama got into office, they egged him on for roughly the first 4 years of his presidency, and were cheering on many of Obama's foreign policy actions. That could arguably could be described as neocon.
Hillary Clinton just got a big endorsement from Robert Kagan. You talk a lot about Kagan in the films. Lay out his story. Why should the voters be concerned about a guy like Kagan throwing support behind Hillary Clinton?
Well, I think the main reason is that he was the co-founder of the Project for the New American Century, which of course is this, very influential neoconservative think tank. But why I think Kagan is particularly dangerous is because he's really good at appealing to liberalism. So when you see this new op-ed that he's writing, it's essentially an anti-Trump screed saying that the GOP is making a huge mistake by letting someone like Trump take over. And whether you agree with him or not on that, I mean, I'm sure many liberals would agree with that. It's very fascinating to watch the way he's characterizing the situation. He calls Republicans Islamophobes, bigots. And I would agree with him on that. But this is language that usually liberals and people on the left wing use. And in the end of this op-ed, he basically says that he has little hope for Rubio and Cruz, and Hillary Clinton's foreign policy is more in line with his ideology than Trump or pretty much anyone that he hopes in the GOP field right now. So, I mean, I think it gives an interesting insight into what I was just talking about, this, that partisanship to the neoconservatives isn't as important as getting their foreign policy message across. And Hillary Clinton apparently is someone who is going to deliver that message and is more in line with the neoconservative ideology than Obama even. And they've actually said this. Other neoconservatives are saying now that they would have rather had Hillary Clinton as president in 2008. Because she is so in line with the way that they think.
And, she's been getting, huge money from the defense industry. They've given to the Clinton Foundation. So Hillary Clinton is really right along with these people. I mean, her views on foreign policy are much more aligned with what we saw from George W. Bush than, say, her opponent, Bernie Sanders. With Bernie Sanders, we're not going to get, 4-8 years of endless war. Hillary Clinton, we don't know, but we can look at her donors, we can look at her advisors, and we can see that these are problematic. But back to Kagan a little bit. Is Kagan still in the picture? Does he still have influence over foreign policy today?
Well, he was, I think inside the actual U.S. government, I'm not sure how much influence he still has today. I think very few people realize that his wife, Victoria Nuland, has an incredible amount of influence inside the Obama administration. And Robert Kagan was actually appointed a position in the State Department by Hillary Clinton when she was appointed Secretary of State. So not only does he have sort of a influential, arguably, we don't really know what his direct influence is, but his wife has pretty much been in charge of the Eastern European NATO policies for the last 4 years in the State Department. And, arguably she had a role to play in sort of the Ukraine situation that erupted a couple years back. So I think that that's, what people should be looking at is, Victoria Nuland and Robert Kagan sort of as this power couple that have inserted themselves into U.S. government policymaking and foreign policymaking.
You just mentioned Ukraine, and that's another point I want to get to that you discuss in your films, is the media's role in all of this. A couple years ago, Liz Wall from RT America decided on air she was going to announce her resignation, saying she could not work for this, Russian propaganda network. I guess you could call lucky. Mike Papantonio was filling in for Tom Hartman. We were in the studio when that happened. And there was just this sense of shock among everybody there, and more of a, what the hell are you talking about, than a right on, do the right thing. Your sister, Abby Martin, was a host on RT for a very long time. And so, you know, Liz wanted us to believe that there is this big, you know, Russian conspiracy. They're trying to, you know, influence the media. I haven't seen that. Have you?
No. I mean, I have, you know, I mean, Russia Today, you know, has put out some stuff that is maybe, you know, a little bit Russian leaning. It's understandable. It's a Russian-owned television channel. You know, Tom's program, Abby's program were very much editorial content. It was all sort of their own, you know, opinions bringing to the table, bringing guests on. I think that criticism can only really be leveled at like the sort of the news content, the news cycle content they do. But even still, I mean, compared to the Western media, it's completely dwarfed by sort of the slant and the obvious propaganda that the Western media is putting out, CNN, MSNBC, even, of course, Fox News. So, yeah, it was completely ridiculous for Liz Wahl to say that she can no longer work for a Putin, a network that whitewashes the actions of Vladimir Putin. I mean, it's straight out of a neocon script. And then, of course, it was revealed later. And I don't know if Max Blumenthal, Rania Kallek, or were the ones who actually discovered that. But the Foreign Policy Initiative, which is Project for the New American Century 2.0, announced on Twitter something big is about to happen on RT in about 20 minutes. And that was Liz Wahl's resignation. So for some reason or another, this neoconservative think tank wanted to put out the message that they were trying to sort of launch this, I would describe it almost like an information war against Russia. Not even just against the network. It was something, I think, deeper than that for them.
And, you know, as you mentioned in the films, they need an enemy. You have to have this enemy to unite the public in your quest for war. And Russia, you know, God, since the Cold War, for decades now, that's kind of always been our go-to enemy. You know, oh, something's bad. Russia did something that we, you know, we do the same thing elsewhere, but they're doing it. So now we all have to be against it. Americans unite. We have to be ready to go to war with Putin. I mean, it's ridiculous when you consider, you know, some of the real foreign policy crises that we have in this world right now. I mean, we have areas that are being decimated by climate change, you know, horrible dictators out there. But the U.S. wants to be the police. We want to say that you have to do exactly what we do, exactly what we say. You have to model yourselves after the United States, and we see how well that worked in Iraq, rather than offering help. And I think that's the big problem, is that we've turned from a helpful nation into a war-hungry nation. And I don't see this changing anytime in the near future, especially when we look at the people running for president today. Do you see any hope among any of those people for any kind of change?
No, I don't. But what's interesting is there seems to be a weird neocon, I would call it almost neocon panic over the Trump presidency. And of course, potential presidency. I'm not reading into that in the sense that, you know, that means that Trump is somehow going to have good foreign policy. But it is interesting to see how much they're freaking out over the potential of him winning. And I don't really quite know what that means, except for I think that it's they're not sure about him. He's such a wrecking ball. You know, he's gone in there and sort of upset their show so much that they're already talking about sort of rigging the Republican convention or having a brokered convention or whatever, so that he, even if he gets enough votes, that he won't even be allowed in. But what's also interesting is I see a problem now is a lot of Trump supporters are starting to use the term neocon because they see that neocons are actually so upset over Trump and they're starting to use it. And I always get worried when sort of a vitriolic, blowhard sort of group of people starts using a valid term like that, because, you know, there's always a danger of something, a word like that becoming meaningless and becoming sort of weaponized in the election cycle. And that's, I think, what I'm fearing right now. But it just in terms of good foreign policy, I mean, I think we are pretty much screwed in terms of our options. I mean, I am not even really thrilled with Bernie's foreign policy from what I've seen. So I don't have much hope, to be honest.
Robbie, film series is a very heavy agenda. Where can people find it?
They can get a DVD copy of it at veryheavyagenda.com. It's a three-part series, so it's actually three different DVDs. The third one is coming out in late March, and they can also watch it streaming online at the same website.
Excellent. Robbie, thank you very much for talking with us today. We appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Talcum powder is an ingredient in countless over-the-counter consumer goods, but it turns out that the powder is not as harmless as most of us believe. News has emerged recently showing that there is a direct link between talcum powder and ovarian cancer in women. And Mike Papantonio recently spoke with attorney Wesley Bowden about this connection.
Wesley, Jerry Beasley really stepped up in trying this case over in St. Louis. And I say that because, you know, Jerry has a long history as being a really outstanding trial lawyer. This was a case where the government was not doing their job. They completely were at asleep as far as regulations. The industry was not doing any kind of self-policing. They knew they had a problem as early as the 1980s, but they were unresponsive to doing any kind of policing at all. Then you had the media, which never really picked this story up because they were afraid of offending Johnson & Johnson, because Johnson & Johnson is such a big advertiser. So in that, Jerry Beasley stands forward, and he goes forward with this case, just gets a tremendous result in St. Louis. And I know you're handling these cases, and our firm's handling these cases, but I want to talk about the fact that sometimes it takes a Jerry Beasley to make everybody wake up and make everybody understand, have these women understand that they should not be using talcum powder, period. What is your take on this? How bad is the relationship between ovarian cancer and talcum powder, like the case that Jerry just tried?
Oh, there's no question. It is horrible. Every year, there's about 21,000 cases of ovarian cancer diagnosed, and of those, about 14,000 deaths. So this is an incredibly serious disease. And of those 14,000 deaths, what came out in that last trial with Mr. Beasley was that about 10% of those, at least 10%, are related to talc powder use. So this is not an isolated incident. This isn't a one-off case. This is something that is affecting thousands upon thousands of women every year in our country.
Well, I know you've evaluated this case, and I think the reason that you think it's such a strong case is you're finding that there actually is remnants of the silica from the powder that's being found. The minerals are actually being found in the tumors that are being removed from women's bodies.
That's right.
I mean, that's kind of smoking gun kind of material, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. What they're seeing is that sometimes women will go in, they're having problems, their doctors will actually see that their ovaries are inflamed, and they do what's known as a tissue digestion study. When they do that, a pathologist looks at the tissue underneath the microscope, and they're actually finding particles of talc in the ovaries, around this inflammation, and actually in the tumor themselves. So there's no question what's causing this. I mean, talc is actually getting into the ovaries, and it is causing cancer.
One thing these lawyers one thing that's developing here, and I think it's just so important, the International Journal on Gynecological Cancer came out with a fairly extensive study where they showed that there was a 30 to 60% increase in the risk of ovarian cancer for women who were using this powder. When did this kind of information start developing? When is it that Johnson & Johnson knew or certainly could have known that they needed to take a closer look at what was going on here?
Well, unfortunately, the answer to that, I think what really got this jury so incensed was that they've known since the 1980s. In fact, they started looking at this, the link, in 1982. In the late 80s, even the government became aware of it. But what's really sad and what's really the tragic part of this is that because it's a cosmetic product, talcum powder is used in a wide variety of cosmetics, but because it's considered cosmetic, The FDA doesn't regulate it. They rely on Johnson & Johnson to essentially self-regulate. And of course, you know, that leads to disastrous results here, where they don't even put on there a warning when they've known about it. Their executives have been talking about it for decades, since the 1980s at least.
Wesley, what are you looking at when a case calls, when somebody calls and they say, I think there may be a case? What things are important for people to understand and be aware of when you're advising them? What types of things, what types of questions should you be asking?
Well, you know, and this type of case, it really is, what we're looking at are women who have used Johnson & Johnson products, talcum powder, baby powder, really any type of baby powder consistently. You know, you had mentioned the study previously that showed a 30 to 60% increase. Harvard actually did a study in 2008, Harvard University, that said women that use talcum powder even just as little as once a week increased their risk by 36%. If you start using it daily, it jumps up to at least 41%. So, you know, one of the things that we want to do is get the message out there that this is a dangerous product, because Johnson & Johnson isn't going to put a warning on their product. The FDA isn't going to regulate it. And so it's up to people, to lawyers, to take the right step, and like what Mr. Beasley did, and make sure this message gets out there. So when we look at these cases, we're looking at women who have used this product for years and that are now faced with a very tragic set of circumstances in their lives.
Even after the results that took place here, even after a jury looks across the room and tells Johnson & Johnson, that, by the way, I think it's remarkable, Shook Hardy's name pops up in here as being, I don't know if they're still defending him, but, you know, Shook Hardy is, of course, the people who defended the tobacco industry. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what it takes to get through to these folks and say, listen, isn't it time you just take the product off the market? Why should you put anybody at risk? The risk benefit, there is no risk benefit analysis. I mean, you don't have to use baby powder. You don't have to use this product called shower to shower and put yourself at any kind of risk.
No, you can look for a product that contains cornstarch. A lot of manufacturers, not all, but a lot of manufacturers of a baby powder type of product have switched from talcum to cornstarch. But let me comment on what you just mentioned about how, what is it going to take for Johnson & Johnson to change what they're doing? I don't think that anything can change it. Let me read you something that Mr. Beasley put in his last trial. This is an internal memorandum. They had an investigator that they hired as a third party to look into this, and this is what he said. He said that, quoting a prior internal memorandum, he said that in that prior memorandum, it says, human studies on talc and cancer in the industry settings have shown that industrial exposure to talc, both by skin contact and inhalation, even at levels thousands of times higher than lifetime consumer exposures, present no significant risk. And here's the part that really drives it home. This investigator says this statement is outright false. That's in 1997. Mm. When you have your own investigator telling you that your statements are outright lies to the public and you don't change your conduct, I don't know what will.
Will you, going forward, Wesley, if people call, will you be willing to share the information that you have about this case? And so I think as much information as we can get out there, the better.
Absolutely.
All right. Wesley Bowden, thank you for joining me. Good luck with this, okay?
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. You can also subscribe to our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com. And you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.